The Citizen Mike Show. News. Commentary. Interviews. Citizen Mike Show starts now.
Welcome to the Citizen Mike Show. Thanks for tuning in. We do appreciate it. My name is Mike Burdinsky. Ralph Tomaselli has got the night off. He will be back next week. This is the episode for December 15, 2016. Special guest in the studio, Peter M. Joya, an economist with the Connecticut Business and Industry Association. Mr. Joya, thanks for coming on the show.
Well, thank you for having me.
Just almost every show that Ralph and I produce on the Citizen Mike Show, there's some aspect of economics involved. And we always get into the state issues and the budget and taxes and all that kind of stuff. Okay. So we're especially anxious to talk to you about you know, what's going on. Before we get into some of the details about what's going on in Connecticut and in the world in the world of economics, take us on a tour through your organization, the Connecticut Business and Industry Association.
Well, CBIA is the largest statewide business association. We're sort of equivalent of a statewide chamber of commerce. We've been around since 1815, so we've seen a lot. Unlike a lot of other business associations, we have a lot of substantial services that we provide. We provide health insurance to thousands of companies. We provide energy aggregation to nearly 1,000 companies. We do human resource and safety programs for folks, economic programs. And one of the key things we do is we advocate on behalf of business at both the state capitol and with the regulatory agencies. So we're very involved in anything that happens in the Connecticut state legislature. But that's sort of the once over lightly of CBIA.
Good. From your resume, I see that you oversee the research department at CBIA, and you provide all kinds of in-depth analysis to your customers and clients. You are an expert on state fiscal policy. You're a frequent speaker all over the state, including now the Citizen Mike Show, I might add. Prior to joining CBIA, you were a senior consultant with KPMG, Pete Marwick, and you've been with CBIA since 1989. Let's start with the basics. What's going on in the state of Connecticut? How do you take the temperature of the state? What's the state of the state's economy?
Well, the state's economy is underperforming compared to competitor states such as, you know, Massachusetts and New York. And whereas we have been growing out of the Great Recession, we're only right now at 69% job recovery compared to 150% in the U.S. and over 300% in Massachusetts. So we've got a ways to go. And that's particularly disturbing because there are a lot of jobs that are going begging because we don't have people with the right skills to fit them. In terms of economic potential, though, we have enormous economic potential. If you take a look at the base industries in Connecticut, particularly in manufacturing, financial services, and research, including bioscience, we have a mix of industries that's the envy of any state in the U.S., any country in the world. We have tremendous potential. And unfortunately, we do have some pretty good long-term deals with some key providers, Electric Boat, Pratt & Whitney, Sikorsky, who together have over 1,000 subcontractors throughout the state of Connecticut. And so we've got a generation's worth of work and growth that can come from those folks. The other thing that I see coming on is that whereas financial services has been struggling somewhat, we do see that our friends in Great Britain have shot themselves and their financial services feet. And the likelihood of some of that global business from London migrating to the greater New York area, including overflow into Fairfield County, I think is quite real within the next 5 years. So there's a lot of areas with potential. The problem is that we're not living up to our potential in any noticeable way, and that's something that's going to change for everyone to have a much better feeling about the state, for young people to feel like, wow, let's stay in Connecticut. This is great.
You mentioned Brexit and what's going on overseas. I just want to expand that that real estate just a little bit and get your view on to what extent national and global pressures other than Brexit, which you've addressed, but such as globalization, technology, just the role of the United States in the world economy generally, is Connecticut sort of being buffeted around?
Well, I think Connecticut has potential from there because Connecticut firms, particularly in those key industries I mentioned, they don't sell just in Connecticut. They sell around the globe. They sell around the U.S. And as the globe improves, as the U.S. improves, it provides markets for our goods and services. And these companies sell these goods and services to these other localities, and they bring the money back here. So that's a key, and I think Connecticut's pretty well positioned on that. And that should provide, you know, another basis for, you know, economic growth and economic hope going towards the future. Now, with a new administration in Washington, there's going to be some challenges with that because, you know, there's a heavy anti-immigrant, heavy, anti-trade agreement feeling with the new administration, and that could provide some challenges. On the other hand, there's certainly our potential for tax cuts. There's potential for regulatory changes that will benefit business. There's potential for investments in transportation and infrastructure and in defense, which also could benefit Connecticut. So that's sort of a wait-and-see picture, but on net, I'm hopeful with that.
I'm going back in time now, and when I was a kid, getting into high school, out of high school, college, of course, we were in the days of the Vietnam buildup.
Mm-hmm.
And it seemed like, and this is a question, you know, more than it is a statement, it seemed like no matter what your education level or skill level, given the Vietnam buildup and the helicopters and the jet engines, you're pretty certain to get a pretty good paying job in Connecticut in view of that.
Mm-hmm.
But it also seems that those days are gone forever. I just want to get your reflection on that.
They're not gone forever. They've changed. Okay, a couple of things that have changed. One is that in 1989, when the Berlin Wall fell, it fell right on top of Connecticut manufacturing, and we really got dealt a body blow that only now we're beginning to come out of. We're coming out of it both from the fact that the defense products we produce now are more in vogue, particularly in submarines, and we've got a huge commercial buildup, as well as companies that have nothing to do with defense or commercial aviation that are starting to grow. But manufacturing itself has changed. It's much more capital intensive than labor intensive, and the labor that is there is totally different. I mean, it used to be you worked with your hands. If you had some strength, you know, metal bending, whatever, you didn't need a lot of education. Now you need education because the manufacturing workers are working in a clean environment and they're operating computers and machines. And that requires a level of skill and education that is far different than those kids in 73 were coming into the workforce with. And so, you know, you need a lot more in terms of training. You need a lot more in terms of education to fit into the modern manufacturing environment.
Do you have any notion as to how much a young adult can make in Connecticut's economy if they go into this high-tech manufacturing? What kind of a life, if they get the right skill set, you know?
You can start at 40 to 50, and you can make 60 to 120. And this is not as a manager, this is a worker. I mean, you're involved with a company like Trump with lasers, a lot of their people make $100,000. Same thing with skilled machinists at a lot of the aerospace companies. So there are, and these companies all pay full benefits. Benefits that you don't get these benefits working in fast food and retail. Okay, there it's totally different. It is a middle class, upper middle class lifestyle with, you know, home ownership and a nice car and, you know, ability to send your kids to college and all that sort of stuff. So, you know, it is every bit in the state's interest to get our manufacturing going as strong as possible. And I think there's a fair amount of commitment on the part of the administration to help do that. But I wish the same amount of interest was as prevalent throughout the legislature. There are people who are supporters. There are other people who I don't think have a connection with, you know, what's good for business, particularly these types of businesses, ultimately is good for working families. That you can't be pro-business, you can't be anti-business and pro-worker. You can't be pro-family and anti-business.
Your destinies are linked, this is what you're...
They're totally entwined.
Yeah. I pulled this off the Record Journal editorial page. It goes all the way back to before the election, so there's a little bit of... You probably sense a little bit of politics involved here. It goes back to October 25. Mm-hmm. But it deals with the economy, and I just wanted to get your reaction to,
sure,
to what's going on. This is a quote. Connecticut residents are fleeing the state. Businesses are staying away because taxes are too high, and the economy is headed off a cliff. Sound familiar? It should. This dire proclamation, or a variation of it, has been relentlessly trumpeted by local Republicans running for seats in Hartford and Washington, and the message has resonated. With voters soon heading to the ballot box, Democratic lawmakers from Connecticut running for re-election are pushing back. Speaking with a Record Journal recently, U.S. Representative Elizabeth Esty, who represents the 5th District, decried that message, putting forth doom and gloom. You would never do that in a company and expect good results, Esty said. You should never do that. State Representative Joe Arisamowitz, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, Joe, the House Majority Leader, went even further, accusing some of misleading voters when discussing the state of the state. We started with that discussion.
I think there's some hyperbole in that. Yeah. On the other hand, you know, I survey business people all the time. And besides the direct answers to the questions, we get a lot of editorial comments in these. And a lot of the editorial comments sound like that or worse. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's quite a bit of frustration that has been there and I think is still there with a lot of people. That being said, as I led off, I talked about the enormous economic potential of Connecticut. But you don't reach that economic potential when you have $1.5 billion budget problem, when you have threats of taxes, when you have legislatures who, over the last 20 years, every session they raise these incredibly anti-business bills that play into companies when they're planning. Because if somebody's going to make a major investment, it may be a 5, 10, even 20-year, and particularly in pharmaceutical, payback. They've got to think, well, gee, you know, these proposals didn't go anywhere last session or the session before, but they're likely to get raised again. And what if they come true? How does this play into our, you know, return on investment of this commitment that we're making? And it does send a chill through that planning process. And, you know, we survey companies about, you know, are you making investments? And the majority of them are. And the majority of them, thankfully, are making them in Connecticut. But we also hear from about 40% of the companies that say they're investing out of state. So I ask them why. Why are you investing out of state? And, you know, a minority of them say that they're doing that because they need to be closer to their customer. And if you're a company in South Carolina or Florida or Texas or whatever, you need to be close to your customer too. And so you could ask that question of all those and you'll get some that are saying they're investing out of state. But when you hear the other reasons, and the other reasons are Connecticut is such an anti-business state and I'm unsure with this fiscal situation about my taxes, and you're Therefore, I'm making investments outside of Connecticut. Those are opportunities and jobs, good jobs, that we're losing. And that is not good. So what we need to do, we're never going to change the I need to be close to your customer, but we do need to change those other things and make those investments instead of going to Kentucky or South Carolina to go to Wallingford and other towns and communities in Connecticut.
Well, let's follow up on that thread. We'll get to the budget in a minute, which is an immediate issue, you know, mm-hmm. but what you're talking about is sort of intermediate, longer range stuff that'll have traction over the years. What specifics has the CBIA been pressing for along the lines that you were just talking about in Hartford?
Well, the first thing is do no harm. Just as in medicine, you know, you won't. I would love for the governor and the legislature on the first day of the session, which starts January 4th, to say, we're not going to raise and we're not going to pass, and for the governor, I'm not going to sign any legislation that's perceived to be anti-business, because right now the economy is job one and we need to create opportunities for our people in this state.
Why won't that
happen? That's the first thing.
What's going on there? It seems simple enough.
But there's pressures from other people. There's groups like the Working Families Parties that say, oh, well, the rich don't pay their fair share, forgetting that we chased out 50 rich people in the last few years, and they account for about a quarter of our loss of income tax, because people and companies can move. You know, they're not stuck in cement here. And there are very active and very aggressive efforts from other states to lure our companies, because, as I said in the very beginning, we have a base of industry that is the envy of any state in the country. And so we're a target. And it's not just, you know, North Carolina and Florida. It's Massachusetts and New York. So, you know, we have an ongoing fight. Yet these people think that, well, okay, well, we're going to raise the minimum wage to $15. If you don't pay people $15 an hour, we're going to do a special tax upon you. Without realizing that ultimately that comes back to bite you, because either the company moves investment, or if they get hit with one of these things, what do? They substitute people for capital. Automation.
Meaning automation.
Automation, yeah, okay. Robots or kiosks or other sorts of things. And right now, credit availability is great. Our surveys show that. The banks are well capitalized. They are willing to lend. They are very quick to tell companies, hey, buy some machinery that's labor saving. We'll underwrite it for you. You know, so, you know, we don't operate in a vacuum. We operate in a highly competitive environment that's not only competitive nationally, it's competitive globally. And we operate under a situation where you can do capital and you can do labor.
Of course, Connecticut has to pay the bills, and we'll get to the budget in just a second, but we're talking about sort of more longer range things. One of the longer range initiatives, and one of the initiatives that has drawn some praise and criticism, is Governor Malloy's program of issuing grants and forgivable loans to certain companies. But this is a question, the focus has changed a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But can you bring us up to date as to what's the status of those kinds of programs? Where are they going, and what's your view?
Well, let's talk about the programs that are really good, okay? Probably the best of them is something that's called Small Business Express. It applies to companies that have 100 or fewer employees. If you work with the Department of Economic and Community Development and apply for this before you hire people, you get some monetary assistance in order to train those people for your company. That's a really good program. And that's, I heard the governor today, I think he said that's added like 18,000 jobs in Connecticut. Those are jobs, many of them probably wouldn't be here if they didn't have the program. So, again, these are jobs that are good-paying jobs with benefits. It makes sure people don't tap into any state resources, and ultimately they are taxpayers. And not only income tax, but they go out and they buy stuff, and sales tax, they buy homes, property taxes for towns. All of that's beneficial. So, you know, programs like that are important. I think it's important for them to look at that for larger companies. And I'm not talking multinational corporations, but I am talking companies that may be here that may have 250 employees, may have 300 employees, and may be looking for another 100. You know, that's a good deal. And as I mentioned, we had talked today at the office, and we know dozens of these companies that are out there that are looking to add considerable numbers of people.
Well, why can't they just go to a bank if they need cash?
Well, you know,
because it's, you know, getting a grant, it's, or some sort of assistance from the state is cheaper.
It is more complicated.
Okay.
And again, you know, you can go to a South Carolina and they'll say, y'all come on down and we'll work with our school systems and provide people who are trained specifically for your company. So again, it's a competitive environment.
Well, again, back to these grants to companies, and I think three or four of them have been in Wallingford. We read in the newspapers periodically at $4 million, you know, potentially forgivable loans, a match to some sort of $1 million grant conditioned on, you know, a certain number of employees over three or four years.
Let's remember, the Department of Economic and Community Development folks aren't dopes. There are clawback provisions in practically all of these programs. So you've got to meet certain thresholds in adding jobs of certain quality, or they come back, take the money. You're on the hook. So it's not, here's a pot of gold, you know, go play with it. It's, here's a pot of money, but you've got to meet X, Y, and Z requirements, and we will audit you on those. And they do. They give reports to the legislature every year.
Have those programs proven to be effective?
Most of them have. You know, I can't say I've heard complaints either from, you know, legislators, the department, or from business people on some of these programs.
So I've been reading now, again, this is a question, not a statement, but I think the emphasis is on clusters of industries like maybe the bio in New Haven.
Yeah, biotech, insurance, manufacturing.
What's your view of that, and does that have a chance?
Well, you know, it's been in play. I think it has been working to some extent. You know, again, you know, there are uphill drives in a lot of these, and there's a lot of competition, and there's a lot of, you know, challenges sometimes in getting the right fit.
So we have to get in the game. We have to continue
We have to be in the game. And quite frankly, you know, you got a choice. Okay, you only got a limited amount of funds, and you can use them to bring companies in here, or you can use them to, with existing businesses, to expand. You're going to get a lot more traction with existing businesses to expand, because quite frankly, sometimes the price tag for luring companies in is very high, and you know, the best way to lure companies in is when they want to be there anyway, and you don't have to do much luring.
So to just sort of button this topic up, in order to provide this kind of assistance for the companies, my understanding is that some of that money, if not all of it, has to be bonded. We pay principal and interest. I gather from your comments that it is worth the price to do that.
Yeah, I think that most, you know, I think if you look back over the history, in most cases, you know, there are mistakes that get made, but, you know, in most cases, it's been well worth it, especially compared to some other things that we've done with our money.
Yeah. I want to focus on the budget for a little bit, and then we may come back to some of these more macro issues. We've been reading in the newspapers that Governor Malloy has proposed a new way of forecasting at least expenses, maybe revenues too, but I think at least expenses. And the proponents of this new way of forecasting expenses for the purposes of setting a budget the proponents say is more accurate, not as misleading. Yet it seems to have turned into somewhat of a partisan issue because the Republicans are saying, no,
Prior to working with Pete Marwick, I was working with the Office of Fiscal Analysis, which is the legislature's budget office. It's the legislative equivalent of OPM. And OFA has had a practice of producing budgets based upon what they call current services. And what they do there is they assume that every program that's in place is going to continue with an inflationary uptick.
Like 2% or something
like that? Or 3% or whatever.
Yeah.
Okay. OPM almost never budgets that way, particularly in tough times, which we've had for, you know, well over a decade. What they do is they go in, they strip out that inflationary expense, they say, we're going to continue this program, we're going to continue that program, we're going to modify it, we're not going to continue this program. So it really isn't that accurate a forecast, and it gives a bloated picture of deficiencies within there. So it is more accurate to take a look at what's most likely to happen, not guarantee that all programs are going to be continued and budget in that
way.
Well,
is this that big a deal?
It gives two sets of numbers.
And do you have a sense as to what the disparity is between the two? Because I'm trying to figure out how significant this is.
Oh, it can be big. It can be $600-800 million on a year. So it is.
So is the practical consequence by going to this new way of forecasting that the anticipated needs go down? Is that the impact of it?
Well, basically, it tries to get a better handle on how much you're going to really need in revenue to fund your programs.
As opposed to the old system,
which would say you'd need a lot more.
Which built in did not contemplate
changes. It didn't contemplate management.
So you like the new system?
Well, that's the way I would propose it if I was the head of OPM.
I just didn't know whether I should be for this or against it. But it's something I should support.
There are different opinions on that, but you know, I think the OFA way was inflated.
Okay. Now, another development in the last couple of weeks was a deal, and I want to come back to that word, that deal between Governor Malloy and the unions about how the state is going to fund pensions. And just my understanding is we have these unfunded liabilities. Sooner or later, we're going to have to pay the bill when these people retire. And if we, sooner or later, it comes back to roost. Give us an overview as to what this is
all
about.
What has happened is, you know, the governor, to his credit, realized that we have these massive unfunded liabilities, particularly in the pension and other pension benefits area, and said, you know, nobody's dealt with this. Not only do we have to pay our obligation, but we've got to pay an additional chunk of money to defease this unfunded liability.
I mean, set aside a little bit.
Right, and it's not a little bit. It's been to the tune of $200 to over $300 now million dollars a year. Ultimately, under the schedule that was in place before, it was going to go into the billions, which it's just not going to happen. We're not going to have a year where we've got $4 billion lying around that we can do this. And so they did stretch out the payments. The real kicker is what's been done, I don't have any great problem with. But ultimately what has to happen is you've got to bring the unions back to the table and deal with the size and magnitude of the overall problem.
But they've got contracts.
They've got contracts, but those can always be renegotiated.
But if they say it's not going to be renegotiated...
If they say it's not going to be renegotiated, then you've got to find money in other ways. And, you know, one of the ways it's happened over the last year is layoffs, and I don't think, you know, the union rank and file necessarily like that option.
Well, I'm going to get back to the layoffs in a second, but I want to get back to this, the leveling of the pension payments. What's the matter with a pay-as-you-go approach to state pensions? As state employees retire, they're due a pension, they're due a pension payment, raise the funds to pay
what... The problem is
yeah.
that if we had been doing that since the 80s, that might work or might take care of most of the problem. Problem is we haven't. We've mm-hmm. actually had years in the 80s, such as during the Weicker years, when we had budget problems, where we didn't make any payments at all.
Well, how do the pensioners get their money?
Well,
do we borrow it or what?
Well, we just kept pushing it down the road. Okay. And we didn't deal with this accumulated problem. This isn't something that just happened in a year or two. Before the governor came on board, this had been building for over 20 years. So, you know, you've got 20 years of problems. You're not going to erase them overnight. I think with his first deal with the unions, it's unfortunate he didn't do a more aggressive deal with them than what he did.
So the notion of a deal, what did the unions give up? What did they give? I'm having understanding what's the agreement.
Let's go back to how these originally came about, because I think that's important in it, because, yes, we do have contracts. Contracts imply contractual obligations. But when former legislatures agreed to these benefits, you know, normally in the private sector, what you would do if you were going to have some of these increases in benefits is you'd benchmark your industry versus other industries, because part of what you should do with those benefits is attract and retain qualified people. I mean, that's the whole reason you should be doing it. You know, you might say, oh, well, gee, you know, everybody deserves a pension. Well, you know, private sector, everybody doesn't get a pension. So,
That ship has sailed because we've promised
right.
them
but
benefits.
Basically, we negotiated these benefits that were extremely rich with the idea, well, it's not my problem. I'll be out of the legislature. I won't be governor when the bill comes due. Guess what? The bills come due. And so, you know, what our present governor is trying to do is make that bill more manageable. And you might not like the idea of stretching out payments, but you've got to come up with the fact that, you know, given the current base, would we ever be able to pay what we've got?
Deep inside the recesses of my skeptical brain, I'm wondering what Malloy gave up. I can see a situation where some of these, the funding is stretched out, I think I read 14 years, and at the end of 14 years, the legislature and the governor then in place say, still can't afford it. And so the unions, unless they are just advocating for their current position, you know, their short-term next 5 years, mm-hmm. I don't care. It's the guys that come after us mm-hmm. that have this worry if the pension.
Well, you know, that's a legitimate worry given how we've been doing in terms of job growth. Ultimately, one of the ways you solve this problem is you get more job growth, you get more revenue, and you can afford more payments. But in order to do that, you've got to get the current budget in order, and we don't have a handle on that.
So we've been talking about labor contracts, and I every time we have brought it up in the past, we come down to the final conclusion. They have state employees have a union contract. It expires on a certain day. Mm-hmm. I can't see that they're renegotiating a contract that's in force now unless you can. And when the new contract comes up, if you can't come to terms, it goes to arbitration.
Well, you know, I'm of the belief that, you know, you can get a situation where the contract that's in place now can get modified. But, you know,
By mutual agreement.
That's not an easy thing to do.
You need carrots and sticks to do
But, you know, eventually the contract that they have will expire. And you've got, if you're a union person, you've got to say, well, gee, am I going to be in a better position when that happens? Or am I going to be in a better position now?
Is it true that if you're already retired, the current union can't mess around with your benefits?
I believe that's true.
So the
and if someone did, you can bet there'd be a lawsuit.
Oh, yeah. So the current benefits being paid to retirees now, they're locked in.
And they're quite substantial.
And that's what we call fixed cost, part of one of the, yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. There's another sentence in a, I think it was a Hartford Current article about the amount of the pension contribution is based in part upon how much return you expect to make on the cash you mm-hmm. have invested. And if you think, I'm making this up now, you think you're going to get an 8% return, you can afford to contribute less because your investment pays you back.
Right. And one of the other problems that we had, which was addressed in this most recent agreement, was the rate of return. The rate of return had been 8.5 a few years ago. It was lowered to 8. Right now it's been lowered, I believe, to 6.9.
That's what I'm reading. Okay. And I'm wondering, is that realistic to get 6.9% of your money with interest rates being as low as they have been?
First, it's a hell of a lot more reasonable than 8.5 or 8. Okay. Second, there are people who will tell you that's legitimate. There are people who will tell you lower, too.
Yeah.
A lot of it depends on how the U.S. economy performs going forward. My guess is on net, after the election, the U.S. economy is likely to perform a little better than we thought it was going to. Certainly the market has shown that. The market's now moving at one heck of a clip. And, you know, to support not only 6.9, but a number a heck of a lot higher than that. Is it going to continue to do that forever over a 30-year period? I think that's a little optimistic.
Yeah. Let's focus a little bit more on the budget if we can. I think I read a sentence, I'm trying to find it, that was on your website, that recent analysis strongly suggests the deficit for next year is greater than 1.3, maybe 1.4, maybe 1.5, and the following year maybe $1.6 billion.
Okay.
You have fixed costs that...
Let's modify
that
somewhat, and let's talk about fixed cost, okay? With the most recent agreement, I don't know exactly, but we're probably have trimmed that a couple hundred million. Okay, in terms of what we'll be contributing each year to take care of the pay-as-you-go and some defeasing. Also, you know, the second year equates to doing nothing the first year, so you got to take that into account. There have been reports that, you know, over 50% of the budget is fixed cost. Well, let me tell you something. If you're going to do a budget, and you're going to do it right, you start from ground zero. Okay, so you don't have anything in there as fixed costs. There may be things that come into it, but you've got to do a budget based upon what kind of state do you want going forward? What services are A priorities? What are B's? What are C's? In a budget crisis, which we're in, you probably can't afford to do C's. And the B's, you better figure out which ones are really A's and which ones are C's. And then you've got to take care of your A priorities. That's probably what we can deal with going forward. Now, you know, so you've got to start with that basis. And the other thing that you've got to do is say, that the way we've always done things may not be the way we always need to or should do things going forward, too. And I'll give you a couple of areas of what I see as low-hanging fruit that are out there. Okay. Two of them we've been making a lot of progress on. Okay. One is long-term care. I do speeches all the time. I've spoken in the last 18 months to probably 5,500 people, and I ask them the question, if you had the choice between high-quality home care or high-quality nursing home care, if you were in that situation, which would you prefer? And I ask, how many people would want high-quality nursing home care? And I ask for a show of hands, 5,500 people. I've gotten two hands, two. Okay. Everybody wants...
They're all optimistic they can stay at home.
Everybody wants home care. Now, to be realistic, home care isn't what everybody needs. There's always going to be 10-15% of the people, maybe more, that have got to have skilled nursing care. And that's really expensive. It's about twice as expensive as home care. But right now, we've got about 60% up from 50, so there's been progress, who get the home care. The rest get nursing home care. Other states are at 85 and looking to press to 87%. If we were at 75%, which is a stated goal for the state of Connecticut by 2020, and we're probably not on track to meet it, we're close but not meet it. If we get to 75%, we spend $600 million less on long-term care. So we're spending money on a service that people don't prefer and in many cases may not need, and we're paying more money for it. And I think in a budget crisis, you can't afford to do that.
Another example.
Another example is corrections. To his credit, Governor Malloy introduced the Second Chance Initiative.
And to a lot of people, that means freeing convicts that shouldn't be freed.
Let's
demagogue.
Let's talk about this, okay? One of the things I've been advocating for with a lot of the commissioners is to get the hell out of Connecticut and get to states that are dealing with problems that they have who are solving them. And there are states that are doing this. You know, if you wanted long-term care, go to Oregon. If you wanted corrections, one of the places to go to is Ohio. And to his credit, current Commissioner Scott Semple sent people to Ohio because their recidivism rates were a hell of a lot lower than Connecticut.
You're saying commissioners. I just want to make sure we understand what you mean.
State commissioners.
State commissioners.
Who head departments.
Okay.
So Scott Semple heads the Department of Correction.
Okay.
They went to Ohio, found out what they were doing. They had reentry prisons where they had people who they thought would be eligible for reentry and who would be reentering society one way or the other, whether they were changed or not. And they clean the people up, they give them education, they give them real-life job skills. They're training people for manufacturing.
Are they institutionalized while they're doing this?
They're in an institution, but okay. It's more like a school than a prison.
Got it.
But it's got gates and barbed wire, and you can't go out and all that stuff.
Okay?
Yep. So, you know, they've been reintroducing people who have marketable skills and who have a path to reentry. And whether we like it or not, 90% of the people who are in prison will reenter. Mm-hmm. Now, we can have them reenter without skills, still drug addicted, no job prospects. And what do you think is going to happen? They're going to go back to their gangs. They're going to commit more crimes, maybe more violent or more serious. And they're going to be recidivists. They're going to get arrested. They're going to go back to prison. At $50,000 taxpayer cost per person. Or we can get them so they go out and they get a job. And they at least contribute and maybe become taxpayers and are not recidivists.
I just want to clarify the concept a little bit. So let's take someone who's going to serve 8 years. You know, that's the sentence, and let's say it's fair, just, and reasonable in our hypothetical. Mm-hmm. Take that hypothetical convict, and sort of walk us through how this would apply.
Okay, well, hopefully, in the last 2 years, if not the last year, if they've had, you know, a good record in prison, they get put into a reentry situation.
Another facility. They get skills.
They come out, they've got some supports, and they actually become a worker.
They have more of a chance,
right,
because of
and,
this.
And that doesn't just affect them. It probably affects some young woman with kids. And so, you know, maybe with their working, the young woman with kids, it's not on welfare. So there's a lot of upside if it's done right. And what I've been saying is we need to do more of this.
Are sentences shortened, the ultimate time they spend in an institution?
Some may be, but not necessarily.
That seems to be the flashpoint.
Not necessarily. And you know, I'm not a soft on crime person. You know, I've been involved in the reentry stuff, and sometimes some of my opinions shock the people there, because how can you have these opinions and be in favor of reentry? Because my opinions could be a little radical, and I won't get into those. Okay.
All right.
But you know, ultimately, you know, we got a lot of people in for drug offenses. We got a lot of people in there because they're stupid kids. And what has happened in the past is the stupid kids don't get anything to prepare them for reentry. They go out, they can't find a job, so someone in a gang or someone who's still in prison before they get out gives them a job, and their job is to be their henchman on the outside. So they commit more serious crimes, and they come back into the system. We have done a spectacular job over the last 30 years of turning stupid kids into world-class creeps. We can't do that anymore. We can't afford it on several levels. We can't afford it on a public safety level, and we can't afford it on a taxpayer fiscal level. We got to do something different. So this isn't just providing government services. It's rethinking what services and how they're provided, both in the long-term care arena and in the corrections arena, because there's a lot of money being wasted and lives being wasted. You got people getting services they don't want. You know, people deteriorate in nursing homes, whether you like it or not.
So what are the odds? What are the odds of these two proposals or initiatives that we've been talking about, the home care and the reentry system? What are the odds something material is going to happen in the legislature?
I think there's good. First, they're desperate. They need ideas. They're grasping for straws. They're grasping for ideas.
These are legitimate.
I don't know of anyone when they're properly explained, including by, you know, the commissioners or people involved on the ground. I don't know of anyone in the legislature who's opposed to these types of things. Part of it is, well, they don't know if the department can handle it. There may be institutional opposition in the department. I mean, people got jobs based upon the old system. Oh, you know, at the very least, I got to change my job, you know. So, but we've got to go forward.
Well, I'm trying to filter out some of the noise I think I've heard, but I think I've heard some legislators in the general circulation area of the Record Journal saying that these kinds of programs release criminals before they should be released, and it creates a dangerous society. And I hear what they say. I don't bother to research independently what's going
on.
Well,
you know, part of what they're doing, and they need to do more of, is they do a lot of behavioral analysis on these people. Trust me,
yeah.
I am absolutely opposed to situations that lead to Cheshire-type people getting out. That's the last thing we need. And there's probably 15% of the people who are incarcerated, and I've talked to former commissioners who've used that number, who should never see the light of day. They're just evil. You just can't have these people out there. So as I mentioned before, I'm not a soft on crime type person, and I don't want those type of people out. But, you know, a lot of people are going to get out. And of those who are going to get out, I would much rather have them get out and be workers than get out and be gang members.
I want to come back to the notion of fixed costs to sort of button up this topic. The impression that I think many of us are getting is that there is so much in the budget that cannot be budged in the way of debt service, in the way of medical costs, in the way of retirement benefits that are locked in. They can't be modified.
And if you look at the budget from that way, you're never going to get to a solution.
And they want cities and towns to be held harmless and not have
again,
a cut there.
If you look at the budget that way, you're never going to get to a solution. You've got to look at it in a different scope. You've got to look at it as to what you really need to do, what are the real priorities, what needs to be done to be successful. And there aren't enough people looking at things from that perspective. Now, I'll give you another area. Nonprofit provision of services, okay? And the governor has made progress on this. He's privatized more of the services. There have been TV ads against it and all this stuff. But ultimately, we can provide a lot more care to a lot more people by having a lot of the work done by not-for-profit providers.
Why is
rather
that?
Than state employees? Because of the pay and benefit scales. You know, it's just way too expensive, and because of the bureaucracy that's involved with it, which adds another layer of cost.
So an issue connected with that is oversight and standards.
And span of control.
We've heard stories from across the country about said supposed so-called nonprofits having management organization. They make a lot of money, but there is a lack of...
Yeah, I think you could
prisons,
go to
privatized prisons is one of those.
Well, I'm not advocating for privatized prisons.
But it's an example of a nonprofit, you know...
Well, most of those are for-profit, not-for-profit. Okay.
Yeah.
What I am saying is if you go to any of the major Connecticut nonprofits like an Oak Hill school, they're not making a lot of money. They're scraping by. And you know, I think in certain of these cases they may need more support. But even with somewhat more support, they can still provide the services at a lot less than what is the current
situation. Just a voice in the woods. That'd be Citizen Mike here. Just a voice in the woods. I have no, I don't think, philosophical objection to outsourcing some of these to nonprofits. However, if I get a whiff that the state, who may have some responsibility, are sort of washing their hands of oversight and not following through on it.
That hasn't been the case. If anything, the oversight can be claustrophobic from what I've seen.
Yeah.
But, I mean, just take a look at management, for example. A lot of these not-for-profit organizations have pretty lean management. That doesn't mean there can't be improvement. That doesn't mean there can't be consolidations. But compared to the state, they're pretty lean. Span of control in a lot of the state agencies is 1 to 6, one manager for six line workers. In the private sector, practically no one's less than 1 to 10.
Yeah.
And some a lot more. Even the federal government is 1 to 10. Okay? So it's even other governments function a lot leaner than we do.
So I'm hearing layoffs. I'm trying to boil this down to what I can expect. I'm hearing layoffs in favor of outsourcing in a way that avoids labor law complications.
I haven't said, and I've never been an advocate for laying off state workers. We got a lot of people in state service with white hair. You can accomplish all of what I'm proposing with attrition. You just don't rehire people. Same with the prisons. You don't rehire corrections guards, because guess what? You know, every year we're losing several hundred corrections guards to retirements.
Right.
So, you know, the thing is that's got to be managed.
Changing the focus just a little bit, from time to time we hear about a spending cap. And or in this op-ed, it was a real spending cap, something that has teeth and has regulations and definitions. And this op-ed was in the Hartford Current, November 20, written by a guy you may know, a fellow called James C. Smith, chairman and CEO of Webster Bank.
Sure, I know Jim Smith quite well.
Yeah, and so it seems to me like it's too slick a solution. I mean, like it's avoiding the problem. You pass a spending cap, everyone feels good, but then you still have the hard decisions you have to make.
That's true, but You know, I think over the next 4 to 5 years, even the spending cap with teeth would not be come into play, because what will guide the state in terms of what it can do isn't a spending cap level of approved spending as much as a lack of revenue, okay, to meet that. Even though we have huge amounts of revenue and a $20 billion budget compared to 1992, we had a $6 billion budget, just to give you a scale. But I think that we need to introduce a spending cap, because after 5 years or so, we may well need it. And the original spending cap that was approved by the voters, 81% of the electorate in 1992, I think is something that works, because it's got safety valves, but it says that your spending could be the maximum of the rate of inflation, mm-hmm. or 5 years average of personal income growth within the state, both of which are reasonably tight. And there are economic factors that say, okay, state spending should grow with the ability of the economy to pay for it.
Yeah, right.
And I think that is, you know, a wise thing. The problem is that was sent to the legislature to approve, to ratify into the Constitution, and they've never voted on it.
Yeah.
So the critical thing is the original spending cap has got to be put before this legislature, and they got to vote on it.
So we have less than a minute left. I'm going to give you the last word on this topic. To what extent are you optimistic that in 5 years we're going to be in a materially better spot?
Well, you know, it certainly isn't a given, because we have this horrendous budget problem. But I think if we can get through this, and I think that there won't be stomach for tax increases, and the governor's already said he won't do that. We've got a different legislature, so, you know, you've got to get 19 votes in the legislature to get tax increases. They're not going to get any from the Republicans. They're probably not going to get any from as many as 4 Democrats who are in there. And if the governor says no tax increases, they're not going to get it from Nancy Wyman. So, you know, you got to solve it on the spending side, and that may involve some really tough things, including some negotiations with the unions. But I think that we will get there. And if we get there, I think we set the stage to have some increased business confidence in the fiscal future, to get some increased business investment here rather than those reasons they've gone to other states. And we've got a base of industry that can really power the economy. So I am optimistic.
Let's make that the final word. Peter Gioia, thanks for coming on the Citizen Mike Show. We appreciate it. Our viewers appreciate it. Hope to see you again.
Anytime.
5 years when we have our, you know, when it all comes true.
Or before then.
Thanks for tuning in. We produce the shows on Wednesdays. You got to see it Thursdays at 9 o'clock. If that doesn't work, Fridays at 6:30. After that, it's video on demand on WPAA.tv. After that, it's Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday at 9. Hey, if it's 9 at night, it's Citizen Mike. Good night, everybody.